Good morning to all of you here at the Vilnius City. And before anything else, I would like to request you to accept my thanks for allowing me again to come back and share to you the message of the Lord. It's a great joy and a great privilege for me to come, especially to be introduced by my son. He said my dad, so he's my son. And by the way, those are my grandchildren. Yung speaker ninyo. Aside from the two, we have three still in Manila, hoping to come at God's timing, maybe next year, 2 years from now, whatever is planned. So thank you for giving me the time to share to you the Word of God. This is a very unique church because you are giving already the outline message to your speaker, so it's not really very hard for us as people to come up here and preach, because you have already guided the thing for us ahead of time. So also I want to supplement good meat and skeletal portion of the message that you have for the month. And by the way, I have observed something different here in your church. And what is that? And guess what? You know, I noticed in my calendar of activities for the past year and even this year, I noticed that if I preach in your church, it always fall on the month that has 5 Sundays. Almost every month that has 5 Sundays, the 5th Sunday of that month, or one of the Sundays of that month, is my turn to preach. So I said it's a little bit significant for me in the sense that I am the first Joel in the family because I'm the father, and the junior is the second Joel. And your pastor is the third Joel in the family. And that student pastor there, Joel, also is the fourth Joel in the family. So it might be you are giving another title, Joel the fifth, Pastor Joel the fifth Sunday. So anyway, just kidding aside, I trace out my calendar of activities for the past year, and this year I noticed that very, very significant. Every month that has 5 Sundays, one of those Sundays is mine. So this is the fifth, not really the fifth Sunday, but one of the months that have 5 Sundays I am going to preach. The message that I am going to share to you this morning is very self-explanatory, very simple, and it is actually written in the Word of God there, read to us in the book of Acts, chapter not 12, as flashed in the screen. That's maybe the computer was a little bit sleepy. It's the 12, but Acts 17 instead of the 12. And this past experience of the Apostle Paul is very exciting because the Apostle Paul is a missionary and a church planter. The truth and fact in the scriptures is that he planted different churches in the area in Turkey, or Asia Minor today, as we call that. And those churches stood open in the preaching of the word as they followed their church planter, the Apostle Paul. But when the Apostle Paul preached as a missionary, he went on several journeys, first missionary journey, second missionary journey, third, fourth, and there was even part of it, the fifth missionary journey. The only tool that he used to spread the good news is the scriptures, not the Bible that we have today, But the scroll that he used to have, sharing this in different places and even in the synagogues and temples. As usual, when you preach the word in different places, you will always suffer what we call pressures, both positive and negative pressures. Positive because people are craving for your presence, and more preaching, more study of the Word of God. Negative pressure is that people will stir up other people and create a mob to hinder you in preaching the Word of God. So when you preach the Word of God, whether you are a missionary, a church planter, a pastor, a Bible study leader, expect always two pressures. The pressure to do more and the pressure to stop. It's your choice whether to proceed or not to proceed. However, in the case of the Apostle Paul, when he traveled to different places, he always chose the positive. In spite of the fact that there are pressures for him to stop, and even he was incarcerated in some instances, he pursued his goal to preach the Word of God. And it's a paradox in his life because the Apostle Paul, when he was still Saul, was the one who persecuted the preaching of the gospel. He was the one who authored persecution of people who would gather around and talk about the Lord and study about the Word. He was the promoter of persecution. In fact, and in truth, he traveled somewhere to kill and slaughter Christians, until finally, on the road to Damascus, he met the one whom he persecuted, the Lord Jesus Christ. He was stricken by that bright light, and he fell on the ground, as if dead. But he heard a voice from heaven, and it was the voice of Jesus Christ, the one who he persecuted several instances, and said, "Why are you persecuting me?" And he said, "Who are you?" And the answer was, "I am Jesus, whom you are persecuting. If you are persecuting those people who talk about me, and if you are persecuting those people who study of me, you are persecuting me myself." And from then on, there was a real conversion in the life of this man. From Saul of Tarsus, he became the persecuted Apostle Paul. He preached several times in different places. And you will notice that in our text, if you can read chapter 16, part of it, you would notice that there was a mob in the group that was actually trying to snatch him away with Silas, snatch them away and put them isolated so that they can stop preaching and spreading the word. You see another drama? He continued preaching the word. There were some group of people who tried their best to organize a mob or a group of those who would like to persecute and to stop him. And they snatched them away somewhere else. And these two, Paul and Silas, hid themselves somewhere else through Jason in the course of this story. And then they were snatched to another place in Berea. There they were. And you will notice here in our text given to me, in Berea, there were some group of people already ready for the coming of the gospel. They were not really Christians in the sense, because they were still expecting a message about Christianity through somebody else. But this time, God programmed it to be Paul and Silas. So they went to Berea, and they preached the gospel. And then there were some people again in that place. They were already Christians. They organized some kind of a group that would destroy the prison in Berea. And I'm telling you the background of the story because I will inject some things here that can provide you some kind of an insight to proceed with the preaching of the gospel and the word of God itself. Don't look at my necktie this morning very much. It's a very unique one. I bought this in Korea long time ago. The reason why I bought this, because this is a very unique kind of a tie. You cannot buy this anywhere here in Winnipeg, and maybe in the old Canada don't have this. I bought this in a corner for the reason that here in the necktie, you can see the cross and a couple of Bibles displayed. So it intrigued me during that time. I didn't have any wants or money to read. I borrowed from a friend and said, I don't have money for that. Would you lend me a couple of your wants and I will buy that necktie and bring this to the Philippines. I was still in the uniform and it matched with my combat uniform. So I wore this in the army for several occasions to preach the word. So when I preach the word, when I focus on the gospel or scriptures, most of the time I will use this necktie because it displays something that can encourage people to love the scriptures. Today we have noticed that there is the lessening or reducing of the visibility of the scriptures in our organizations and churches today. In fact, if I will ask all of you a very simple childish question, if you brought your Bibles with you this morning and show it to me, and I will give you 10 bucks if you have, I think there are only some of you who have scriptures, correct? I even would go to churches sometimes without this because all the scriptures are already printed in the screens, the scripture readings, all this are there. Seldom, if not at all, less in our places, these scriptures. But long time ago, since I am very old, during our days, when we were young, the bigger Bible you have, the proudest man you have in town. Sa amin dati kasi palatihan ng Biblia, maganda pa yung pagkahawak, ganito, hawak-hawak yan, naglalakad ka sa kalsada, pakita mo pa sa kapaligiran mo na yung Bible. Palakihan ng Bible. Ngayon, pataguan ng Bible. Ha? Pinapaliit ng Bible, pinapatago pa, pag binasa ko minsan, patagot pa rin. I don't know. I don't know to you, but that is only my observation all around. I do not want to be prejudiced, but some of you are reading your Bibles privately, and that is good. Some of you are reading your Bible before you sleep or after you wake up in the morning and then all this. But so much about that, I would like to emphasize what the Apostle Paul in the text would say. This morning, you will notice that it was read that in Berea, there were some group of young Christians, maybe, those a small group, waiting for the preaching of the gospel and for the spreading of the news. But there were some people, like the Thessalonians, who gathered around to destroy the occasion. So you would notice that in verse 11 of chapter 17, there is a kind of comparison between the small group of Bereans and the bigger group of the Thessalonians. Which group you belong, it depends upon you. The Bereans are there, and the Thessalonians are there. Only in verse 11 alone, you can see the comparison. But one thing very evident here, in verse 11, is that the writer, Dr. Luke, put up a kind of a favor, or a kind of congratulatory remarks for this group of people we call the Bereans. And it says, This word more in my translation here, the New King James Version, fair-minded. In the old King James Version of this text, they were more noble people than those in Thessalonica. You would notice that there was a comparison. The Bereans were called fair-minded and noble people as compared to the Thessalonian Christians who heard the news already beforehand. So you see, there was a comparison. I would like to highlight this morning the word noble. So allow me to go back to the old translation, the old King James Version, noble, instead of fair-minded. Fair-minded is a little light, you know, in weight. But when you say noble, it's a very strong word that would imply strong in character, strong in quality, and you are great in this sense because you are noble. So nobility is the title of the message in the scriptures. Nobility comes from the root word noble, which actually means great in ranking and title. It also means great in character and quality. Do you follow me? Very simple. Noble. Let me give you a shotgun introduction of this text by saying this much. Flash on the first screen right now, on the second screen, this simple thing. This introduction is a message in itself, if you like, to be shortened. First, one of the most precious gifts God has given to men, aside from His only Son, who is the Lord Jesus Christ, is His Word. What is that? The Scriptures. In the book of 2 Timothy chapter 3 or chapter 2 verse 16, the first few words says, all scriptures is given. Instead of a continuation, you just pause for a moment and make that appear. All scripture is given. When it is given, it implies a gift. I give it to you as a gift. The scriptures, therefore, the Bible, all the Old Testament scrolls are given to us. The most precious gift that God has given to us, next to His beloved Son, Jesus Christ, is His Word, the Scriptures. If you have the Scriptures, take them as a gift from God Himself. I need to elaborate on that. Second, one of the most powerful instruments God is using to break the hearts of men is His Word. And what is that? The Scriptures. In the book of Hebrews chapter 4 verse 12, it says, the Word of God is alive, quick and powerful and sharper than any two-edged sword, piercing even to the dividing asunder of the soul and marrow, and it penetrates and breaks the heart. The Word of God is being used to break hearts. I saw people incarcerated in different places in the Philippines. I visited them several times when I was still in uniform. I talked to them. I preached the Word of God to them. Many, many times they would sob, cry, and accept the Lord Jesus Christ through the message of the Word. It breaks. You know, you read the Scriptures, you would notice that if you are serious in reading the Word, sometimes you are convicted and tears will just roll down your cheek. All alone, inside your privacy, you read the Scriptures, the Lord talks to you directly, and it breaks your heart. The Lord is still using it today. Many people who are drug addicts, when they read the Word of God many, many times, they would sob and break their hearts before the Lord. So, number three, one of the most profitable tools God employs to mold the lives of men and women today in the world is His Word. And what is that? The Scriptures. The Scriptures in 2 Timothy chapter 2 verse 17 would say it is profitable for doctrine, for reproof, for correction, for instruction in righteousness, that the man of God may be fully well equipped to do good works. So with those things that I mentioned already, we can close our eyes and have a closing prayer, correct? But that is not yet the message. That is only part of the introduction. The message is very capsulized today, and I would like to focus with that right now. The next slide that I will present to you, I would say that if you can follow me, I will give you some guidelines that nobility in God's Word is cultivated in three different things, or three different areas, okay? Are you following me? Nobility in Scriptures is cultivated and developed by the following. I would like to stick on verse 11 and 12 this morning. First of all, why is it that the writer of Luke, or actually, who is Luke himself, said that these people in Berea are noble-minded and fair-minded compared to the Thessalonians? Remember that the Thessalonians, rather, are already Christians. Maybe babe or mature, it depends. But they are all Christians. But Luke said, the Bereans, who are very young and babes in Christ, expecting more preaching of the word. They were noble-minded and fair-minded. The simple reason is, number one, is that they received eagerly the word of God. See that in the screen? You can read it very carefully. Receiving eagerly the word of God with readiness and strong desire to listen to God's word. Always looking and longing for the opportunity to hear the word of God. I need to read all those verses, like 1 Peter chapter 2, verse 2, and Hebrews chapter 4, verse 12. I made that already in passing. But let me ask you a question right now, and direct to the point. Take it or leave it, the question is like this. God has given us 24 hours a day. How much time, the question is, how much time do you give a part in a day for Scripture? That's a question. I need not ask you to answer me right now. You think it over when you go home. How much time within 24 hours do we have time to read the Word of God? I would like to sound off a little alarm here, that we are living in a world today that is dominated by the superpower, we call that the prince of the power of the air, Satan. And Satan is always trying his best 24 hours a day to grab your attention from reading the Word of God. Take it or leave it, that is a warning, but I am giving you right now. We have spent so much time in entertainment today. We have spent so much time in gadgets today. How much time? It's up to you to think about that. We have spent so much time in watching all things that are being flashed in the screens. How much time? Maybe 1 hour, 2 hours, 3 hours. We have spent so much time in our trouble all around the world, if you have that ability to do it. We have spent so much time in sports and games. We have spent so much time in telly series, maybe. But my question is very simple. How much time in a day you spend for a simple verse to think about and read? These Bereans became very noble or great of quality people for the simple reason that I have read in the Word, in that they receive the Word with readiness. They receive the Word with readiness. They were longing for a time that they can read scriptures, can hear scriptures. That's good. Number two, they were not all taught because of reading earnestly the Word of God. They were not only doing the hearing, listening. They went back home and searched the scriptures. I did not say that. The Word of God says it. In that, they received the Word with readiness and searched the scriptures. The word search simply means you open up and research, and you cannot research unless you read. That's very logical. So you see that they were ready, they were reading, and they studied the Word of God. What's the result? They became great compared to the Thessalonians. I like that. I like that. After this message, go back home, please, and read again the Word. Search if I preach the truth this morning. I need to elaborate on that, but we'll notice that 2 Timothy chapter 2, verse 15 would say, as I quoted, study to show thyself approved to God, a workman that needed not to be ashamed, rightly dividing the word of truth. You study. I like Bible study. I don't know to you. But I would like to inculcate in your minds that Bible study is very important in our days today. Let us combat the evil spirits that can influence us to do something bad against God by reading scriptures and be influenced by doing something good. Number three, I would like to close with this. Number three is that only reading the Word of God and receiving the Word of God. But number three is relying entirely on the Word of God. The word relying comes from the essence of that word, believe. If you believe something, you cannot help but to rely on it. If you believe, for example, that the plane can take you off from here in Winnipeg towards Vancouver, and the same plane would take you to the Philippines after a few hours in the flight, you believe that it can. So you board the plane and relax and rely on the plane that it will bring you to the Philippines. Believe would give you some kind of a force to rely on entirely without any doubt. You would notice that in verse 11 or 12, therefore many of them believe in this part of the scriptures. So there are three things that we need to think about to cultivate what we call nobility in the Word. Receiving eagerly the Word of God, reading earnestly the Word of God, relying entirely on the Word of God. A group of men and women, young as they were, went to the Philippines several years ago. I was still young during the time, and I listened to the songs that I sang in one of the churches in Cagayan de Oro City. I could never forget the song that I sang very simply. They sang several songs, but one song stuck me in the heart, and I relied on that song day in and day out while I was assigned there. The song has this message: God said it, I believe it, that settles it for me. Simple message. God said it, I believe it, that settles it for me. If God said it, and I put my trust and belief on what he said, everything is fine with me. Everything is fine with me. For example, if God said that he would supply your needs, and if you believe that, you can relax. Tomorrow, there will be something for you. If you don't believe that because God said it, something will happen the next day, you are still worried. Remember the birds? The birds don't worry. They trust the living God to supply them whatever needs they have every day. They trust. Sometimes birds are more than human beings in terms of trust. They don't worry about tomorrow. We do. Why that? Because we seemingly not believe in Him who created us. You see, these people believe in the Word and believe in God simply because they know that what has been preached to them is the God that created the world. So let me recapitulate the simple outline for your own reminder this morning. And this is it. Receiving eagerly the Word, reading earnestly the Word, relying entirely the Word. May God bless all of us. This would make us noble and great people of God today. God bless you.